I am Morten Frisch, doctor in Copenhagen, Denmark. I have been conducting a study on the sexual consequences of male circumcision in Danish men and in their partners. What prompted me was the lack of scientific evidence linking sexual behaviors, sexual satisfaction, sexual functioning to the foreskin status of the penis, which was surprising to me, given the very natural idea that it could affect sexual functioning. And after having considered for a while how to do this, I contacted colleagues in Copenhagen who conduct a survey every around 4 or 5 years, and asked them please to include a question about circumcision status of the man himself, and for the women also a question about the circumcision status of their spouse. And they were willing to do that, and also included a number of questions of about sexual behavior and sexual troubles of various kinds.
What did your study find?
It's important to stress here that most circumcised men and most women with circumcised spouses do not encounter a whole lot of sexual trouble. That I want to stress to avoid stigmatization. But also, having said that, it's important to notice that there were differences between the circumcised men and the uncircumcised men, in that the circumcised men reported orgasm difficulties much more frequently than the uncircumcised men. And more strikingly, and probably also more surprisingly to most, women with circumcised spouses reported considerably more sexual trouble and considerably less sexual needs fulfillment than women with uncircumcised spouses. For the women, as for the men, they reported orgasm difficulties reaching orgasm, or even inability to reach orgasm, 2.5 times more often than women with uncircumcised spouses, and they reported painful intercourse much more often than women with uncircumcised spouses. One particularly interesting feature about this study was that it came out only after considerable struggle of getting it out. Prior to this study, I and my colleagues had published 3 papers on various aspects of sexual dysfunctions and sexual trouble in Denmark, looking at the socioeconomic correlates of sexual dysfunctions and the health correlates of sexual dysfunction, and also the lifestyle factors influencing sexual dysfunction. And all these papers had absolutely no difficulty in getting out. And they were published in the 2 most prominent sexual medicine journals. All 3 papers came out in US journals. But the 4th paper here, including one more variable, namely circumcision, had all the troubles that you could imagine. I did expect it, but I didn't expect it to be so so harsh, the criticism, the way this paper was judged by in the review process was absolutely without precedent for me. I never ever had a scientific review that was so vicious and so indecent and accusing of racism and dishonesty, and all sorts of things were told to us that in order to have the editors reject the paper. It was a kind of obstruction, simply to avoid this paper from coming out. Usually in a scientific review process, you are getting responses back from qualified colleagues around the world who know about the topic of relevance here, and usually get a few hundred words of comments constructive criticisms so as to make your study better and your publication even stronger. But what I faced here was a completely extreme review. You should remember that the paper here that came out was a full 15 pages long article in a scientific journal, it's pretty dull and long and heavy to come through. So I don't want anybody to read it unless they're very interested. But 15 pages. But in this review that came back to me after the first round of review, the reviewer had actually so many comments that it took up the space of 2.5 times that amount of space that I had used in my own paper, which is completely unusual and really shows a very strong and emotional setup of the reviewers. So this had to be stopped, and all thinkable arguments were used to pull our study apart, even though it had previously been published, or the same data had been used for three previous publications with no serious comments whatsoever. But adding circumcision to the variable list made the whole difference, and everything was worthless, according to this reviewer. So that's a study in how sensitive things can be in science, and that's still a subject of great surprise to me, that you can be so one-eyed that you, pretending that you put up a scientific view on things, that all you're doing is promoting your political agenda. Sexual health and sexual trouble is one of my research interests, and I really want to pursue further research in this area. There is, however, one major limitation here, and that is funding opportunities for research in these matters are extremely limited. I have had no great trouble in getting support for my cancer, my autoimmune disease research over the years. However, getting support for things that have to do with sexual health is extremely difficult. Even in a country like mine, which is relatively relaxed in sexual matters, it's just not easy to convince any funding body that this is worthwhile doing. So I would like to have a couple of PhD students to carry out further research on this and supervise them on that. My time limits really do not permit me to be as productive as I would ideally like to be in this area, and I would. But ideally, yes, I will continue, but at a pace that is technically possible and as economically possible, because all the studies that have come out so far on this have been without funding. It's a Conamore project. And why is that so important? I cannot say anything, but it's important because human sexuality is essential part of our lives.